Autoline After Hours is brought to you by Bridgestone Tires, your journey, our passion, and by Lear, a global leader in automotive seating and electrical systems.
This is Autoline After Hours with John McElroy, episode 342 for August 11th of 2016. Is local motors the end of the auto industry? Watch Autoline After Hours live at autoline.tv every Thursday at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. That's 12 p.m. Pacific. You can subscribe to this podcast for free by searching for Autoline in iTunes, Stitcher, or YouTube. Well, welcome everybody back to another episode of Autoline After Hours. We're still up in Traverse City, Gary. Up,
but time will be shifted for this show, so yeah. We'll be back in
Detroit. We're not live.
That's right.
So we got to let everybody know who we got with us today. Go ahead, Gary. Tell them.
Feels like we're live.
Yeah. We got Justin Fishkin, who's the Chief Strategy Officer,
right.
Local Motors. If anybody doesn't know what Local Motors is, it's the first company, I believe, first company in the world ever to 3D print a car.
A full-size car that you
can drive. A full-size car.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, is that right? Can you guys claim to be the first?
For sure. I think there might even be a Wikipedia entry about it. You know, obviously the automotive industry has used additive manufacturing for prototyping at scale, you know, in scale models for a long time. But as far as a car that you 3D print, assemble, and drive out, we're the first.
But that isn't all Local Motors is. I mean, there's another aspect to this company which I think is probably pretty cool, because you are on the leading edge of changing the way cars are designed, not just printed, but the way the exterior comes to be. Tell us about that.
Yeah, well, thanks for saying that. You know, there's two fundamental pieces of our business. One is crowdsourced or open source design, where a global community of engineers and designers and fabricators, you know, who don't work for us, participate in designing our vehicles, and then we pay them a royalty if we use their ideas for the products that we actually make and sell. And on the other side is this micro manufacturing or micro production model, which is that we make in small volume locally vehicles that are demanded in that particular place. And you know, for a long time, Local Motors put out the Raleigh Fighter in 2009, which was the world's first open source car or crowdsource car. We were known as the off-road company. Mm-hmm. And then we did a car for DARPA and delivered it to President Obama. We were known as the, you know, crowdsource military company. And then when we 3D printed a car, we became known as the 3D printed car company. So we're comfortable with, you know, our latest success being what defines us, but I always appreciate when somebody...
You know, and it's interesting the way you guys, I mean, you basically hold contests on the site.
Yep,
so you throw out the requirements, and then you have the community...
Fill in the blanks, fill in the box. We say, here's what we're looking for, what are the best ideas, and hey, are we wrong with our box?
Mm-hmm. And then the community votes on what they think is the best design.
Yeah, depending on what it is, it'll be a community vote as well as sort of a stakeholder vote. So major industrial companies that work with us will also want some say in how their technology is used or the solution that they may be looking for, how, you know, what its characteristics are.
Do you just take those designs wholesale, or do you go, ooh, here's a real good idea on this design and another really cool part on this one and put it together?
Well, as you guys know, probably much better than I do, a car is not just one idea. It takes a large team of different types of experts, and so it'll start with just one visual design, and then we have to run challenges, a number of challenges that follow up on that visual. But the visual, as you know, really gives... is what sort of
defines it.
Yeah, and that's what gets people, you know, to collaborate.
How do you synthesize that, though? I mean, there's got to be plenty of arguments. No, we're not going to use it. Yeah, we are going to use it.
Yes. So, you know, that's Local Motors. We're sort of the project manager, if you will. And every day, our platform's getting better as far as the technology and the tools that we're empowering our community with. We work with Siemens to provide our community with, you know, CAD design software and sort of connecting that digital value chain from, that's a, you know, big three words, the digital value chain, meaning from CAD, which you and I can be, you know, collaborating in two places in the world in the cloud on a model, to a machine in the third place that actually makes it, those one, and translates those ones and zeros into a physical good. That's where we see ourselves as being the differentiator, is that entire chain.
Now, another thing, so viewers of this show who go way back with us may remember we had a guy on the show named Thomas Crum, who used to work for General Motors, and he basically had this idea that it would be better for car companies to have regional manufacturing sites rather than massive manufacturing sites. This is something you guys are bringing to life.
Yeah, so there is a theory out of the UK about microfactory, or it was a paper about microfactory retail. I think it came out in 1999, I think University of Cardiff. And really, we were the first to put microfactories into practice, and it's about small volume, local manufacturing, and the way we're doing it we're calling it upgradable hardware. So we're selling the cars as a contract. You bring it back. If it's a two-seater and your family grows and you need a four-seater, you bring it back. We can strip off the technology. We can melt down the material, and we can build you a new car with four seats. Mm-hmm.
And it's 3D printing that enables that strategy, right? Because automakers have got to tool up the stuff, which means they need mass volume to be able to pay for all that investment.
Right. And so getting back to a conversation we were having before we turned the cameras on, we made a fundamental bet when we founded Local Motors that on an economy of scope, as opposed to, the last 100 years, efficiencies have been gained out of economy of scale.
Okay, explain that.
I'll explain that. Traditional automotive is let's build a big factory to make products with limited variability, some options, and make a million of them. And for each one we make, we're going to get lower cost. Economy of scope basically means that we can't make a million of anything, but we can make more differentiated things, and we can make a higher profit margin on each. So instead of we'll make a thousand of 100 things, as opposed to 100 of, I'm getting confused now.
Yeah, you
get what I'm saying.
But we know what you mean, yeah.
Lots of things, but in limited volumes versus making one thing
in a giant
volume.
Thank you.
So you're giving the customer more choice because you can make essentially any kind of variation.
Yes, on some level. Our model isn't that you'll walk in and you'll design your high school car and we'll print it for you right there. It's more that we're going to allow local communities to define their mobility futures, and we'll enter markets with a couple products that we may have somewhere else, but our intention is that each market that we enter with a microfactory will have a unique vehicle that they have a part in designing.
So are you saying that there would be, say, you guys started out in the Phoenix area, so there'd be a Phoenix car, and there would be a Detroit car,
exactly.
And there would be...
So Phoenix, we actually started in Boston when our founder wrote the business plan at Harvard Business School. Our first two investors were professors there, and started in Wareham, Massachusetts. The first car that the community wanted to build was an off-road desert racer, mm-hmm. the Rally Fighter. And so we decided we had to move out to Phoenix for headquarters. This was actually before I joined.
You needed a desert, and there's not too many in Boston.
Exactly. And so now it's driven in Africa and the Middle East. But that's why our first microfactory was in Phoenix. And then you've seen that in D.C. we've opened in Berlin for our Ollie product, which is an autonomous minibus. The Ollie is the result of a urban mobility challenge for Berlin. Mm-hmm. And then we'll be opening in Knoxville, Tennessee, with our first full-scale production of our 3D printed cars. And that really comes out of our partnership with Oak Ridge National Lab,
right.
And the Institute for Advanced Composites, which is the president's NNMI, National Network of Manufacturing Institutes. We think it's the center of materials research of not just the United States, but the world, or is becoming that. Mm-hmm. And we think that our partnership with Oak Ridge and Cincinnati and SABIC and a number of partners in Tennessee is really what's going to power our 3D printing.
This is an interesting thing. I mean, so I think a lot of people may be familiar with 3D printing in terms of making little tchotchkes that, you can have an iPhone case and things like that.
Yep.
But you guys are working with these technology vendors and material vendors to help make large-scale 3D printing something that is affordable.
Yes. And so it's an interesting position to be in, because what we find is, as the first industrial-scale use case for 3D printing, we're pushing that market forward. And so we're working together with the machine makers and the materials makers to define the spec. And it's what's allowing us to sort of secure long-term sort of strategic advantages, I'd say. But it's also hard. It makes it harder when, you know, insurance companies don't know how to insure a car with no residual value because it's being recycled, and where, you know,
that would be a bit of a problem.
Machine makers, you know, never conceived of making a car with the machine they made, and
right.
so we're in an advantageous position where we're working as partners with across the board with these companies, but at the same time, it's a scary position because we're so far out on the edge across the board as well.
So that's the end. At the end of the life of the car, you just grind it up and throw it back in the hopper
and recycle it.
Yeah.
We call it cradle to cradle. You know, Bill McDonough out of
McDonough. Yeah. I know. Bill's been on our shows before.
We love Bill. He's been a great supporter of local motors, and so. You know, cradle to cradle cars is we think one of our routes to sustainability in the future.
You know, one of the things that vehicle manufacturers know is that a lot of Americans buy cars right off the lot. They go in and the guy says, you know, I got a red one there, you can take it away. In this case, you're talking about somebody ordering a car. So what's the time frame between the order to delivery?
So basically the way we envision it happening and are working toward is you walk into our Knoxville microfactory, which is, think of it like an IKEA. It's a bit smaller, about 50,000 square feet, so the size of an average American grocery store. It's on a major highway, so you know, you drive by it all the time. You walk in, you go up to a screen, you choose your body. Eventually you choose your powertrain. Right now we're starting with electric. You choose your tires and your wheels, and 12 hours later, you pick it up.
Mm-hmm. So 12 hours, you guys keep chopping down the time it needs to take them to print a car.
So I won't say we're exactly at 12 yet, but if you remember, the very first time we did this at IMTS in 2014, it took us 44 hours to print and assemble. Several months before that, when we just tried to do the body, it took us 180 hours. Mm-hmm. And so we're below 20 hours now, and by the time...
Is it you're learning, or the machine's getting better, or both?
It's a virtuous cycle, if you will. Like, we're learning simple things like, oh, if you go this direction as opposed to that direction, you get efficiencies, right? Or if you slow down, it actually makes the whole thing fast, you know? Mm-hmm. And then we're communicating with our machine partners and our materials partners and pushing it forward.
Mm-hmm. So how does something like this get certified for crash and other regulations? I mean, you're talking about cars. I mean,
yeah, absolutely. So that's a multifaceted answer, or there's a variety of ways to answer that. We're taking it through the same process that anyone else has to go through.
Number one, you can simulate so much on screen right now, right?
Well, you can simulate so much on screen, but beyond that, because we can, if we fail crash, with a print, we can change the CAD model, print a new vehicle, and be trying again that afternoon. So the iteration to safety we're finding is a lot quicker. Mm-hmm. And then we can also print a lattice-like structure, fill it with foam, and the fact that it's a unibody is also to our advantage, because what you find is what often kills people is the pieces coming apart.
Right.
And so, look, we think we're going to put some of the safest cars on the road. Mm-hmm. Next year, we might be sitting here together, and you'll say you were wrong, and I'll accept that. But I think what we're seeing so far is that we have a great opportunity to put safer cars on there.
You guys also printed a car at the Detroit Auto Show.
Yep.
And that was my question all along. Okay, they're 3D printing, but can they meet the crash standards? And as I saw it printing that lattice work, which is sort of, you know, in between the inner and outer skin of the vehicle, my jaw dropped. That's when I realized, oh my gosh, this thing could meet the crash standards.
Yeah. Yep. And there's a lot of ways, like if the unibody didn't for some reason, which we think it will, there's a lot of other ways to use the technology, whether it's putting a frame in and then printing the panels, or whether it's printing the tooling, right? So if we want to stay with our scope model, what we're finding is that we can actually make, you know, molds, or we can print the tooling very quickly, rapidly, and that allows us to keep iterating.
So, to that point, you're making a mold. Are you then doing injection molding of certain parts?
We could.
You guys aren't like completely wedded to printing.
We are
only printing.
Right. So if you look at our Ollie product, you know, there are about 30 some, you know, let's say a third of it is directly 3D printed, mm-hmm. or digitally manufactured. A third of it is made from digitally manufactured tools mm-hmm. in our facilities, mm-hmm. and a third of it is glass or other stuff that we're buying. And so
windows.
Our model is such that we want to focus the majority of our production effort on digital manufacturing, mm-hmm. But we understand that there's always going to be a reason to use traditional techniques for different products, and while we want to limit that, we're gonna do it when it's the best option.
And yet, how far can 3D printing go? Because Gary and I go back far enough when they used to call it stereolithography, maybe referred to as rapid prototyping, and it was only plastic.
Yep.
Now these days, they're doing more and more different kinds of metals as well. How far can 3D printing go?
I think it can go a long way. Just seeing the efficiencies we're gaining, on a daily basis, both in the machines and the materials, we're just the beginning of this sort of revolution of digital manufacturing. And so 20 years from now, 10 years from now, it's going to be a whole different ballgame. Look, we're the first to be making large consumer products this way. There's a lot of people who will be doing it.
So simple question that may have a very complex answer. If I go to Knoxville and I order this car, what is it made out of? What is the material?
So it's thermoplastic infused with carbon fiber. For strength. Mm-hmm. We're also testing things so it starts as a pellet with strands. It's plastic with strands of carbon fiber in it. Mm-hmm. And what we're experimenting with is things like graphene additives and other metals.
These guys started in Boston. I mean, they're MIT guys.
Yeah. Exactly. it's a great time to be, because we have this opportunity with great partners like Oak Ridge to be the sky's the limit of what we can test. Now, if we want to put a safe vehicle on the road that people want, we have to not just be, having a good time testing things all the time, mm-hmm. but it is a great period of discovery right now for the entire industry. And because we're an open business, you can come to our Knoxville facility and walk in and say, hey, I work for Ford, or hey, I work for GM, or Alcoa, or U.S. Steel. I want to see how you do this, and we're interested in working with you. And that's the real magic of our business, is that we're not trying to keep what we do secret, and that's what gives us such speed to market. Because, people often ask, what do the big car companies think of you? Do they want to put you out of business? And, my answer has always been, first of all, our business isn't big enough today for them to care. We hope that very soon it will be. But secondarily, the second thing is we are integrating others' technologies. We're sort of like Puff Daddy did to songs from the 50s. He's taking pieces and he's remixing.
Great analogy.
He's remixing them. And so our Rally Fighter had a GM powertrain in it mm-hmm. that you could get serviced at any GM dealer. Our Ali has IBM Watson in it, the first automotive application for IBM Watson. Our Strati 3D printed car just launched NXP's Blue Box autonomous technology. What we're finding is it takes us 2 months to go from concept to vehicle, and it takes much longer cycle time for new products mm-hmm. in traditional automotive.
You're talking 3 to 4 years.
We can keep up with the technology innovation cycles, and we can do it today. Mm-hmm. And so we think that trend will continue, where people integrate their technologies with us first, and we'll pass that choice on to the consumer. What of the latest technology do you want?
Okay, so you mentioned getting it serviced. You had the car with the GM powertrain in it. Let's say Gary goes down to Knoxville, buys a car, goes out, and somebody crunches into it. How do you get it repaired?
We print you a new body, so pick it up 12 hours later. I mean, it depends on look, we're going to learn for each type of maintenance or repair that is needed. We're going to learn what the most efficient and safest way is to go about it. But right now, because it's so quick to, if it's a body issue, so because we can print something new so quickly, why wouldn't we?
So, I mean, one of the things you guys are doing, so you're revolutionizing not only how cars are designed, but how cars are being manufactured. And, one of the things that occurred to me is when I look at the Strati that there's really, the surface is a little rough because of the very nature of 3D printing. Now, there are a lot of people who are obsessed by having, glass-like finishes on their fill-in-the-blank car. Are you guys going to mimic what is going on in terms of how bodies are formed when they're stamped? Or are you saying, okay, this is a new paradigm, this is a new vehicle, and there's a new look?
So, to be fair, with the Strati, we kept it that. So, in direct digital manufacturing, there's two basic processes we use. Additive, which is laying material down, and subtractive, which is milling material to get it smooth. With the Strati, we left it without doing much subtractive because we wanted people to know it was a 3D printed car. Mm-hmm. Because that was our first, and we wanted to be able to, when people said, what is this? We wanted to be able to say it's 3D printed. Now, if you look at our latest model, the Swim, totally smooth. With the underbody of it, you can see some of the mm-hmm. lines because we wanted to do the same thing. But the answer is
that removing material to get it smooth, or are you finding new ways of printing it? Okay,
that's
it's subtractive. Okay,
yeah, and so
just milling the outer surface.
Right. And so you know, what we're working with our partners on now is combining the additive and subtractive in one machine, and then also combining inspection in that machine. Mm-hmm. And so. What we're going to do is pass that choice of how you want the outside to look onto the consumer, because if we say to you, we want these cars to be priced from $12,000 to $60,000 based on the options that you choose, if you go for the $12,000 version, maybe it's
$12,000. $12,000
version, mm-hmm. maybe it's going to be rough on the outside.
Mm-hmm. I got to tell you, I like the aesthetic of the rough look. It doesn't look like anything else that's out there. I actually came to like it.
Well, then we can get you a better deal.
Yeah. Go down to Knoxville.
Yeah. I might have to make the trip. We got to take a quick commercial break. We're going to come back. We're going to be talking more with Justin Fishkin here. We're also going to get a number from Dr. Data. So don't go away, folks. We're going to be right back.
Lear Kinexis offers a parental controls application with geofencing that sends notifications regarding driving behavior and location, including curfew alerts, acceleration alerts, and speed alerts. All delivered to a smartphone application that includes vehicle location, driver notifications, and a report card of driving history, including notifications when predefined geographic boundaries are crossed. For more information, visit Lear.com.
We're back at the management briefing seminars organized by the Center for Automotive Research, and we're going to be talking more with Justin Fishkin in just a moment, but Dr. Data has a number.
We actually have a series of numbers here, and I'm not going to, maybe I'll make you guys guess what it is, and you can participate too, Justin.
Thank you.
And so these are large numbers. Okay, last week we had zero. These are this series of large numbers, and the number starts at 21.5 million, and it goes up to 1 billion. Okay, so these are products. So to your point of talking scope and scale, we're talking some serious scale on these things, okay? So the numbers are 21.5 million, 43 million, 70 million, 87 million, 350 million, and 1 billion. So what products might there be 21.5 million and it is automotive?
You mean out in the world today?
Out in the world today.
21.5 million out in the world today. Mm. You got
VW
me.
VW Beetle.
Oh, okay.
43 million, another automotive.
43 million. I don't know.
Toyota Corolla.
Oh, wow. That's a big number.
And now this goes to your Puff Daddy reference earlier, sort of, okay?
Always comes back to Puff Daddy.
It's in some ways, okay, 70 million.
That was supposed to help, but I don't...
Michael Jackson's Thriller. 70 million copies of that album.
Oh, my God. There we go.
All right. Now, another vehicle, 87 million.
Wow, that's a big number, too. What could be in that volume? It'd have to be like an F-Series truck or something. No?
The
Civic.
Honda Super Cub, little motorbike.
Oh, wow.
All right.
We need to get better at this.
Yeah, right. We're losing money fast.
All right, 350 million. This is not a car, not an album.
It's a bicycle? It's a...
Rubik's Cube.
Wow.
See, now, all right, so that 1 billion, now this is the most popular consumer product apparently ever.
iPhone?
Exactly, bingo, and you win. Yeah, just think about a billion iPhones. You know, and it gets to the point of this conference as we see technology companies that are more and more interested. And you've said in passing that you have the Ollie with IBM Watson in it. Now, so tell us what the Ollie is, because this is a rather interesting technological development that goes far beyond 3D printing.
So the Ollie is a configurable people mover,
or like a little mini bus.
It's like a mini bus, seats 8 to 12 people. I've often said it looks like an iPod on wheels, but it's configurable for either people moving applications or cargo and logistics applications. And basically, with the people mover applications, you call it on an app like Uber. It comes and picks you up and takes you where you need to go, and it sort of optimizes the route based on who else is in the car. So it's for shared mobility. It's electric, and
it's autonomous.
And it's autonomous. There's just lots of applications, obviously, for packages as well as for moving people around. And what you find is, as we were talking about, just like an iPhone, if you know you and I and you might all have one, but they're configured differently. The different apps are used differently, and sort of we view Ollie that way. Nobody knew they wanted a smartphone until it was on the market. Like I liked my StarTAC flip phone. It was, and so we try to bring out products that are vectors for new technology, mm-hmm. and then can be continuously upgraded with the latest technology.
So you guys rolled this out last month in Baltimore.
Yep.
Baltimore. Yeah.
June, actually, at National Harbor, Maryland, right outside of DC.
Okay. And I mean, what was the genesis of this? You're making dune buggies and
exactly. So then we 3D printing cars. Who are these guys? Yeah. We ran an urban mobility challenge in Berlin, and a 22-year-old Colombian student who happened to be at school in Italy won. His name Edgar Sarmiento won this challenge, and we made it and fielded it in Berlin and DC first. Mm-hmm. Sold 10 on the first day, and have sold many more since then. But it took us 2.5 months from sort of idea, or it was like, it goes back, it's somewhere between 2 and 3 months from idea to putting it on the road. And that's
what this is really insane. I mean, because
that's the power of scope, right?
Yeah.
If you're Apple and you want to make a million or a billion of something, you need 800 people and you need 3 or 4 years to make sure it's right, because you don't want to build that manufacturing capacity unless it is. Mm-hmm. We look for beta users first, and we improve with every 5 or 10 that come off the line.
Mm-hmm. So, you guys are taking some risks here, and it sounds just like
you keep
winning and winning and winning, but you must fail at some points. I mean, there must be things that don't turn out so successful.
So our model is based on failure. It's the ability to fail fast, fail often, that allows us to identify the best ideas that will be successful more quickly. And so having not having a dealer network and a production facility and a design team that isn't communicating with the outside world, it's all under one roof, and it's distributed near centers of excellence like Oak Ridge, like Arizona State and others, UNLV, and we're constantly iterating because we are sharing our failures as much as we're sharing our successes.
Mm-hmm.
And
you've got IBM Watson inside, which is probably the preeminent example now of artificial intelligence in the world. How did that come together? How did you plop a Watson in the middle of Ollie?
So, IBM's been a great partner for a long time. They, we did a connected car project with the Rally Fighter several years ago with them, and one of our great partners there, Joe Speed, who's one of the sort of gurus of connected cars, when he saw the Ollie and its applications for urban mobility, said, we got to get Watson in this. And a couple weeks later, it was up and running. And that's, whether it's Siemens or NXP or IBM or any other number of partners, that's the value of locomotives is not just bringing it to market, the new technology quickly, but it's also getting it into a vehicle to be tested and perfected quickly. So that you can iterate to the market, the commercializable
product. So what does Watson do?
So it will continue to expand what it's able to do. Right now, it's cognitive in the sense that you can interact with it as a passenger and say stuff like, is there a good Chinese place around here for food? Or what's the weather going to be like? Or it might say to you, hey, Gary, I see you're running late for work. Should we not stop for coffee this morning? Or I'll drop you off first. because Justin is early for work. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm sure that those are just the beginning, and we have to see as it proliferates how people want to use it. Mm-hmm.
As you project out, as you get more of these Ollies made and all that, what's it going to cost? I mean, if I'm a municipality, say, you know, do I look at a traditional bus as being cheaper, Ollie being more expensive, or what?
So because Ollies are 8 to 12 people, they'll probably be cheaper than a big bus. But what we're finding is the capacity of big buses often goes unused depending on time of the day, and they're fixed routes, so they're always on the road. Ollies are basically, because you're calling it with an app, they can be parked somewhere and just deployed as needed. And they're not running a fixed route. And so we think the efficiencies of an Ollie fleet will end up outweighing the inefficiencies of driving in circles and not having a full bus. It's, you know, we're going to have to, each municipality is going to be different. But the beauty is, with our microfactory sort of system, we can configure for the needs of each municipality. And so I'm not sure that we're ready or to say that we're going to get rid of buses everywhere immediately. But we do think that we're going to power sort of upgradable hardware, mobility as a service in a lot of places very, very soon. And we hope it'll expand from there. And I think it'll start on closed campuses, obviously, because of the regulations. But, you know, I can't tell you how many college campuses have already ordered Ollies. And then, you know, there's theme parks and the places around the world that actually have a different regulatory structure.
So would this displace cars, or are you just looking at in terms of a neighborhood electric vehicle, which is, you know, less than 30 miles an hour and very limited in capability?
So most cities, you can't drive more than 40 miles or 30 miles. You know, the speed limit isn't higher than that until you get on the actual highway.
Right.
Or if it is, people can't, you know, the congestion is such that people aren't driving that fast. So we view Ollie as an urban mobility solution. As we're crash testing our 3D printed cars, if we need a mobility solution that is highway ready, I'm not sure if it's going to be Ollie or if it'll be a new product that we put on the market. But for the moment, it's a lower speed mobility solution in shorter, you know, in more contained areas.
Mm-hmm. Justin, you were at this conference last year, and you shared the stage with Camillo Pardo, who our audience is going to know as the designer of the first generation Ford GT sports car. An amazing design talent. But you guys on stage, as the presentation was going on, said, hey, we ought to do something together. What's happening in that?
So Camille has become a good friend. That was the first time I met him, and such a great guy, and as you say, a great talent. And I think what was sort of news-making at that day was him talking about the Ford GT, and then me giving a presentation, and him saying, I want to design a car for local motors. And since then, he has designed an awesome vehicle. It's actually a three-wheel vehicle. It's called 3E. And it's awesome. And I'm going to show that and reveal it on stage today. And really where we move forward or where we go with that vehicle, the sky's the limit. We hope and expect that we'll make a few units and see what the demand is in the market. And that's, you know, we're a demand-driven business where until we identify buyers, we don't make anything. Mm-hmm. We might make one. But
describe the vehicle a little bit.
It's hard to describe.
Okay. Passenger, two passenger?
One passenger, two wheels in front. One in the back, and it looks like a Ford GT with three wheels. I can't, you know. But what you'll find is Camillo was very astute about. So he came to SEMA to see the reveal of our 3D printed, our second version of our 3D printed car, the smoother one, the Swim. And he got under the hood, and he got on his back, and he said, you know what? I get what you guys are trying to do. And what he fundamentally understands is you design differently for different production and manufacturing processes. And he really zoned in on it and got it with this vehicle. You'll see very clearly that the carriage of it can be 3D printed, and then the top piece that you put onto it that makes it sort of look like a race car is something that you might stamp or mold. Mm-hmm. He did a great job, and so I'm excited to see that come to life.
When you talk to people in the traditional auto industry, now you said that you have a demand-driven model for your business. That's not the model that they necessarily have. Do they ask you about that perhaps more than they ask you about 3D printing?
When I say it, I guess they ask me, you know, we talk about the traditional automotive being supply driven because they sell after they've made.
Right.
And so we don't make until we've sold and until consumers raise their hand and say, I need that product here and I can't get it because, you know, maybe it's not a big enough market that there are a million people who want it, but in my community, there's 3,000 people that need it. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, people ask about it. I think this scope thing that we've been talking about is what really powers it, is that our commitment is that we're not investing in factories to make a million of something, and that allows us to make those things that people actually want.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting that, you know, we've heard over the years car companies talking about personalization, which basically means they put a decal on something. It's like, oh, there's another one that's like that. This is yours. But you guys are basically talking about having, you know, entirely personalized cars.
Yeah, on some level. I think of it a little bit like Nike ID for shoes, where there's a bunch of aspects that are pre-engineered. Mm-hmm. And so we've steered away from customization because there's so many people who want to print that car they had when they were 16. Mm-hmm. And we're at this point, we're not empowering just any car that's in your head we can make for you, because that wouldn't allow us to put a car on the highway. But for the most part, it'll be configurable, and you'll have a range of options that we have tested and pre-engineered, and that'll make it feel like it's a custom car.
Right.
So you're doing all this cool stuff. I'm interested in the business aspect of local motors. How you guys doing? I mean,
we're doing well. You know, it's we're at a point in our business where we're ready to scale, and we are securing the partners ranging from, you know, Airbus to Siemens to GE that are behind us to do so. And so, you know, the way we feel about it is since 2007, when we were founded, you know, with the Rally Fighter, and then, you know, the military vehicles that we did, and now, you know, we do appliances for GE now, through First Build, which is a microfactory they've built in Louisville. We found that our process is actually valuable for hardware industries outside of automotive. Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned, we're doing drones with Airbus.
So, is this the crowdsourced aspect of the development versus the printing part?
It's the crowdsourced aspect plus the small volume before you scale aspect of it. Mm-hmm. Because what you find is the GEs of the world, where there's all the knowledge, you know, in the world about manufacturing, they're great at making one of something and great at making a million of something. But what can happen is they'll build the capacity to make a million, and the demand, and this isn't just GE, you know, this is everybody. They might build something and the demand isn't there, and then you're out of luck. And so what if you can make 1,000 of something, sell those, get feedback, and then, you know, improve it, make the next 1,000 or next 3,000, and, you know, constantly do that. And so that process of both the co-creation, as we call it, and the micromanufacturing is what, you know, big industry is finding valuable. And so we're ready to, you know, we feel like since 2007, we've proven all these proof points. And just recently with the Ollie, I think it was really where we showed, you know, not only can we come to market in a couple months with something that others, you know, have, you know, full global teams and billions of dollars that they're putting toward, we can meet the market where it exists today, mm-hmm. where there's demand for shared mobility, where there's demand for urban mobility. And I think we've proven finally, by each step that we took, so Rally Fighter is a $100,000 car, but it proved that you could field a vehicle that was highway ready by committee, mm-hmm. right? Then you know, print, we had to prove you could 3D print a car. All these steps, we're finally at a place where, with the global demand we've received for Ollie, we've shown the full value of what we do.
Well, I was thinking as you're talking about that, I mean, most companies have teams of lawyers. I mean, that would be, you know, when you say you have a vehicle on the road in 3 to 4 months, I mean, they'd be like, you know, we haven't even started the due diligence on this thing yet.
Yeah, I mean, our last 3D printer car was a month and a half from the first one to the second one.
Gotta love it. So you're reaching all these milestones as a company. You gotta be going public at some point, too.
Yeah, so, you know, not talking about that exactly.
Okay, but I had to ask, because I know the audience would be curious,
you know,
about
whether
that.
We go public or not, it will be a decision when there's actually demand for us to go public. You know, there's obviously lots of issues with being a publicly traded company. That said, we're ready to scale to the size and the sort of global maturation of a traditionally public company. And mm-hmm. we think over the next 24 months, you're going to see that happen, and mm-hmm. laying the groundwork today.
okay, we're at this automotive conference, one of the preeminent automotive conferences in the world. This conference has been going on for over 50 years. Yeah. We've got probably all the major automakers here, all the major tier one suppliers here, and your speech is going to be all about, this is the end of the industry as we know it. We're going to show a video to end the show, but set it up.
So, you know, with that introduction, I'll say, and I'm probably of everybody here, the least knowledgeable about the traditional automotive industry. And I'm comfortable with that because I let everyone know that before I talked last year and before I talked this year. Our vision is, and what we're going to talk about today, is cradle-to-cradle cars, as we talked about, and local recyclability, upgradability of new technology, and just a fundamental shift in how people and communities think about their mobility futures. The way I feel about it is, let's stop, in most communities, exporting jobs to import cars and exporting wealth to import fuel. I think that geopolitically across the globe, if people can employ locals to make the vehicles that they want to drive and other, I believe to make local big again, you got to make big things locally. Mm-hmm. And also this fuel aspect where, communities know that they have feedstocks, be they sun, wind, crops for biodiesel, natural gas, but they can't get the cars to the demand side of that equation to make those things cost effective. So the supply side of energy is there, and I want communities to have the option to make vehicles to run on their own fuels. And I think that takes us to a much more peaceful future and more sustainable future. That's just one man's opinion. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't necessarily say that's the mission of Locomotors, but it's why I'm part of Locomotors.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Justin, it's been awesome having you on. What a great conversation that we've had here, Gary. And this has been terrific.
That's great stuff.
Okay, so we're going to end the show, but just so everybody knows, we got a short video that we're going to run to the end of it, but that's why I'm signing us off right now.
And watch the video. It is very cool.
Real good. Thanks again, everybody.
This is the end. The end of the assembly line. The end of the showroom floor. The end of the smooth-talking salesman. The hard sell. The soft sell. The oversized inflatable gorillas. And overinflated inventory that absolutely must go. This is the end of the junkyard full of old cars leaching chemicals into the ground. Of the 48 mile per gallon smart cars that take an absurd number of resources to build. Born from the concept of cradle-to-cradle manufacturing, printed in front of you to be the exact car you want. Melted, deconstructed, and rebuilt to be the next car you need. This may be where sustainability as we know it comes to an end. Where true sustainability begins.
Autoline After Hours is brought to you by Bridgestone Tires, your journey, our passion, and by Lear, a global leader in automotive seating and electrical systems.
Visit our website, autoline.tv, where you can watch us live Thursday afternoons. Get your daily fix with Autoline Daily and in-depth analysis and interviews with Autoline This Week. There's all that and much more at autoline.tv.